Okay, you guys, we are going to go ahead and get started. So first, you know, thank you guys so much for coming and joining us. It's always such a thrill to see you on Fridays. I really look forward to that. I also look super forward to bringing topics to you that are relevant and new and uplifting and help us in our endeavors to achieve whole wellness, whether it's medical, whether it's emotional. It's all important, and it is all part of what makes us healthy peoples. So with that, I want to introduce you to Dr. Taylor Chastain. She is the National Director of AAI Advancement for Pet Partners. And Dr. Chastain focuses on supporting research and professional development within the therapy animal arena. She has, of course, witnessed hundreds of interactions between her own therapy animals and people, and with great results. I mean, those of us that have animals really know how much they help us, and they support us, and they love us unconditionally. It's so wonderful. She has her undergraduate education in psychology and animal behavior, and her graduate work to become a mental health counselor. She has always strived to shape her education and professional endeavors with the foundation goal of promoting AAI, and she'll talk about that more later. She's also a dog trainer and a pet partners team educator and a registered handler, and she'll talk about more of that later too, which I'm really excited to learn more about personally. And I'm sure I've left something out, and I hope that she'll fill in all those gaps. So with that, I would like to introduce you to Dr. Chastain.
Hello, everyone. Thank you guys so much for allowing me to be here today. I always know I'm in a group with my people if you're willing on a Friday to get on this platform and just talk about animals with me. So I'm really excited to be here. I'm going to see if I can figure out again how to share my screen. I have a little presentation today to go through, but I don't want this to feel too formal. As we talk, I'll pause a few times for questions. I definitely won't talk at you for 2 hours. Just go through some information, and then hopefully we can just have a conversation. I love the idea of a show and tell. Disclaimer, I do have 6 dogs and 3 cats in the house with me right now. So if UPS comes, fair game for a barking interruption. So we'll see what happens. But again, really excited to be here today. I will tell you a little bit more about Pet Partners as we get in. And for those of you who might not be as familiar with the world, AAI stands for Animal Assisted Intervention. So you'll see that reference many times today. But by way of introduction, I do want to let you know why I do this work. You can see in this photo here that's on the screen, this is my heart. This is what's brought me into this field. This picture was taken a couple of years ago. It's the best I've gotten at getting everyone in a photo together. And so those were just some of my dogs. I had 13 dogs at the time and no cats, but 13 dogs, and they needed grooms in this picture, but they still were posing really cute. So I always tell people the real reason I came into this field and got my doctorate was so that I had an excuse to collect animals and society wouldn't judge me for it. So I have a sign up in my office that says, "That's Dr. Crazy Dog Lady to you." But I was a dog trainer when I first got started in this field, and then went on to be a mental health therapist. And at that time, I wanted to start bringing my animals with me to work. And something happened. I got into the office, I brought my dogs, and then I started to look around to some of my colleagues who had wonderful intentions and were brilliant mental health therapists, but had not received much training on the animal end of the leash. And as a dog trainer, it made me very nervous. And so I decided I should go on for more education and try to help bring some standards to the field, not just to protect the animals who are involved in these interventions, but also to protect the people. So that's kind of in a nutshell what I aim to do with Pet Partners now. Pet Partners is a large nonprofit organization, and we've been around for a really long time. It's one of the largest therapy animal organizations in the world. We have an international presence. We're in all 50 states, and we're always looking for people who would like to help us continue to grow that presence. Been around for over 40 years, and we actually register 9 different species of therapy animals. So I heard some conversation about that earlier on. Right now, the species that we register are informed by what we understand from an infection prevention, zoonosis understanding. We see that almost any animal, well, all animals, in my opinion, have the ability to positively influence us. But right now, we register, let's see if I can remember it, dogs, cats, llamas and alpacas, horses, pigs, guinea pigs, rats, birds, forgetting someone, but those are our main species. By and large, dogs represent most of our therapy animals. I have 3 kittens right now. I'm hoping one of them can be a therapy cat, but that's a bit of a harder thing to get. The one who's most friendly is not loving the harness, so we'll see if we can figure that out. Across our therapy animal program, we have about over 10,000 therapy animal handlers all around the world, and they visit anywhere that the love of animals can bring about change. So mostly in hospitals, nursing homes, schools, libraries, but it's really up to the individual passion of the handler and then, you know, the preferences of the animal as well. So we have domestic violence prevention programs, prison programs, and we really just empower our handlers to go wherever they're welcome. We'll ensure their work and help prepare them to visit in that setting. We not only have our therapy animal program, which is, we'll talk a little bit more about that later, and I invite you to check it out if you have an animal who might be a good candidate, but we also do a lot of other work in advocacy. We help with some of the field partners to do things like try to get access for pets to go into to domestic violence shelters, do advocacy around service animal work, which a little bit later on we'll talk about the difference between service animals and therapy animals. And any issue of the human-animal bond, we like to show up. We have a pet week on Capitol Hill coming up, and so we really want to instill that appreciation for animals as much as we can. We're actively involved in research, which I love. I'm a research nerd myself. We fund $100,000 of research a year so that we can say this is not just a cute intervention that people think is fun, but this is science. And there's a lot to the fact that our animals can help us feel better. And we're finally moving into a new direction as an organization into professional development. For so long, most of our handlers were volunteers. So they would come and register with our program and were covered under our liability insurance as long as they were engaging in a volunteer capacity. But a lot of the therapists out there in the world, doctors who bring in animals, they did not have an organization that was really supporting them. So we have big plans in the next year to move into creating services for professionals, which is no better time because our mental health professionals are understandably really stressed given all that's going on in the world. This is one of my favorite pictures here of one of our more rare therapy animal species, but just to give you an idea, our volunteer teams are incredibly active, and last year they made over 3 million visits that they logged in all 50 states. So we're really fortunate to have just an incredibly dedicated volunteer base who go and make these visits possible. So want to go in now to a little bit of conversation about the human-animal bond and about why this is such an impactful thing. All of this being said that we'll talk about today, what I know for sure is that science is only just beginning to understand why we have such a powerful relationship with our animals. At Pet Partners, we define the human-animal bond as a mutually beneficial and dynamic relationship between people and animals that positively influences the health and well-being of both. So we really stress that this is not something that makes us feel better as humans, but it should also be something that makes our animals feel better. In our training for therapy animal work, we have a lot of discussions about consent of animals, about not having an animal who simply tolerates the interaction, but an animal who actually thrives on it. And there's quite a big difference. I have now probably in my rescue world history, have had maybe over 150 dogs in my home in and out as fosters. And it's really not all of them who want to go to work, who want to go out and interact with the public. So we do our best to educate people on what to look for about an animal who really enjoys that interaction. But regardless, almost all animals will enjoy the relationship with a human who builds a relationship with them in a trustworthy capacity. So I do want to go over first just some cool graphics that were created by the Pet Effect, a partner organization, to talk about just the general benefits of pet ownership for all people. And then we'll talk a little bit about the specific benefits of therapy animal work, and then we'll pause for questions before going into the next topic. But there is starting to be a real appreciation of the fact that pets are a really good member of the family for a lot of different reasons. We like to see this appreciation more developed so that people have a easier ability to bring pets into rental properties, things like pet care, you know, there's funds made available. We believe that every person who can and would like to benefit from having a pet should have the opportunity. So that's what backs up a lot of this research. We can see here from this graphic, though, there's been some great studies that look at measures such as blood pressure. We know that people who have pets tend to have a lower resting blood pressure, which says a lot. That relates to pets and cardio health. There's some fancy research out there that talks about how we have healthier blood flow when we have pets in our home. And people who don't have pets have higher cholesterol and blocked arteries. We're only just beginning to understand this. I think a lot of people tend to think, well, maybe it's because if you have a pet, you're going out and walking that animal and it's kind of correlated with other health. But that's not exactly it. We know that walking with animals is healthy, but pets that don't require walking and pets that you're not physically active with, we still see some of these benefits when it comes to heart health and things like that. There have been some studies at specific species. I thought this one was really interesting. A study that looked at cat ownership. And people who did not have cats had a 40% higher relative risk of death by heart attack. 40% is huge. So, you know, everyone go out and rescue a cat if you can after this presentation. But we know there's something going on there about that bond that we have with our animals that really improves our health. This is a slide that we frequently kind of champion in the therapy animal world. We know that pet allergies are a real thing, of course, and we do a lot to prevent bringing any kind of negative impact of visiting with animals. But interestingly, when a pet is in the home, there's some studies that indicate if a child is around a pet, they have a decreased chance of developing allergies. They actually develop human cells that fight off allergies. We'll see if I have children one day with my 9 pets here. They should be basically bionic is what I am assuming. But that is an interesting study that maybe if you expose children to pets from an early age, you decrease the chances of developing some of these issues. Mentioned a little bit about the idea of walking a pet, but we know that obesity goes down when you have a pet that requires walking. And not just pets that require walking, but we know that when you have an animal in your home, you are kind of forced to stick to a schedule. I know when COVID first hit, I was trying to like sleep in late and take advantage of being stuck in my house and to as much capacity as I could, and my pets were not having it. They're like, no, we wake up at 7 and this is what we do. So they kind of help me stay healthy. It's not just physical benefits though of pets. We have a huge anecdotal evidence and also evidence and research that pets help us mentally. There's pets assisting us with feelings of loneliness, pets giving us a sense of purpose and feeling confident. I was so amazed. My dissertation research, when I was going through my PhD program, I looked at survivors of domestic violence who owned pets. And it was fascinating because something that frequently came up was that they were sometimes going through such hard times and, you know, they lost their house. Sometimes they lost their jobs. They're fighting for the custody of their kids. And they said, there were times when I just wanted to give up, but I remember that I had a pet and I had a goal to be able to be in a position where I could get the pet back. And for me, it became this huge symbolism of surviving. So that's one example, but I think we can all think of times when our pets give us a sense of purpose. this idea of loneliness. Well, I think we're in the middle of a situation in life where we are all battling more social isolation and loneliness than ever before. And we're seeing that if you have a pet, or even if you're engaging with pet-based content, which we'll talk a little bit about later on, but watching animal videos, you tend to have higher feelings of warmth and of positive mood. So something to definitely look at there. And that brings us to the idea of the pets bringing us together socially. We hear so many times from our handlers who have therapy animals that they thought that they were getting into this work to share the love of that they have for an animal with other people, but then they end up building these beautiful social connections with one another based off of their shared love for pets. And sometimes people who are handlers in our program are not your typical very extroverted volunteers who feel like they're going to go out and want to just sit by a bedside with people in a hospital, but they do so with their pet and then build these really amazing relationships. Pets have also been studied in relation to post-traumatic stress disorder and have some really promising results. There are service animals now out there just for PTSD, and we have an animal-assisted crisis response team at Pet Partners to help respond in the aftermath of crisis, knowing that pets help increase feelings of love, decrease things like heart rate, they lower anxiety. So there's a lot there for sure. So before I move on to talk about pets, therapy animals, and so just going over quickly some of the really promising findings, I like for anyone who attends one of my presentations to be able to put a fact in their pocket in case we're ever able to go out and be on elevators again. We can have an elevator speech about why this is a serious intervention, but I'll stop and see if any questions have come in or if I should just keep on going through. I know, Sunny, you were monitoring that.
Yes, I believe Alistair had a question. Alistair, do you want to ask the question?
It wasn't strictly serious. It was in response to the initial write-up about Dr. Chastain asking if she was going to address iluraphilia at all. But you did already.
Okay. What is that?
Love of cats.
Oh, there you go. Okay.
Yes. Yes, we have a lot of different, and it's funny, if you have a cat and you think you might have therapy animal potential, please do consider joining or any different species. We encounter frequently either an extreme love for a species, or sometimes a fear of a species in our work. And I'll go and visit sometimes in a senior living facility with my dog, and everyone says, I'd rather have a cat, or vice versa. So if you have diverse species who might be good therapy animals, do consider joining us. We could definitely use more animals in our force.
Do you know if anyone has these as their service animal?
Has what?
The picture.
The photo of the cat?
No. The small picture of my
Oh. Yeah, is that a spider?
Yes.
Oh man. So it's
about 8 to 9 inches from to tip to toe.
Wow. So we actually do. It's funny because we have, not within our organization, but we have a professor who's on our Human Animal Bond Advisory Board, and she has snakes and spiders and all different kinds of fun, smaller animals. And you would think, I've never seen someone be able to captivate a classroom better than when she shows up with those animals. They just, so there's mixed results, but especially when she went into a classroom of adolescent boys, and I thought she was never going to get out of there. So we do a lot. And we also can use different species to not just have the typical cuddly session with our animals, but to develop an appreciation for taking care of the environment, for being humane in our treatment of animals, for understanding different insects and the roles that they play in the whole ecosystem. So there's a lot that can be done there.
Absolutely. Did anybody else have a question? I'm kind of scrolling through. I don't see anybody's hand raised. Nina, yes?
Hi there. Yes, hi. I'm in animal rescue, and so I also have quite a menagerie, just cats and dogs, though. No other no other critters, but I can personally tell you that during this quarantine, they honestly saved my life because I've been furloughed from work, even though things opened up. I'm in Texas because I have chronic kidney disease, so I'm considered high risk. Mm. So they keep me grounded. There's no such thing as laying around all day with dogs. They have to go in and out. I feel like I'm their personal doorman, but I'm telling you, not only do I get the joy of them myself, but I post pictures of them all the time just to make other people happy. So you may see one go over my head on the counter or crawl up in my lap. So I can just personally attest to how much they can really lower your stress level.
Yeah.
Especially I have one white Persian who is a purr machine, and I will video him and play it, and people go, oh my God. But he's just a little love bug, and he will just give you a little quick look real fast. That's Snaggletooth. He's from the Middle East. He's from Doha, Qatar. Wow. But anyway, I just wanted to pop in and say, when I heard about this topic, I thought, oh, that's right up my alley. And to get them as a therapy animal would be great. It's just right now, as we all know, so many places are shut down to even family. My mom was in a assisted living facility for a while, and I would take my two little dogs in there, and just everyone would light up. So honestly, if anyone has an opportunity to take them to a care facility, a place where they allow therapy animals or even just animals to visit, it just really, I've had animals my whole life, my family has. So yeah, definitely. So that's what I wanted to say. Thank you for your
rescue work. And we'll talk a little bit later about ways to get involved. And there is something you touched on with sharing pictures that we've made a way for at Pet Partners. So be sure to stay tuned for that part.
Yes, and I think Tiffany had a question. Tiff, you still want to? I'll unmute you.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes, I can.
Okay, let me just turn you up. I had a call come through. Oh gosh, they keep calling me. I think it might be important. I was just going to say, what I asked was the difference between a service animal and a therapy animal. I'm scheduling a flight to Hawaii, and they're asking me to, they're saying that I can only one therapy animal on board, but I need to be able to, I would like to be able to bring both of them on board. One has to be a service, and the other has to be emotional support. They can't be both.
Interesting. That is interesting.
Yeah, I think that Dr. Chastain will talk about the differences between those. I think Hawaii, on a side note, is different on many levels in that they usually require quarantine unless you have a specific vaccination record within a specific time frame. So maybe she'll be able to answer that for you in a little bit.
Yes, we will talk a little bit about that. And it's a hard thing to keep up with, because even we have advocates who are totally in tune to how, like, the airlines, their requirements, and they're changing quite frequently right now. So we will get to that. So we'll talk quickly about some of the studies that show that, you know, this is more than just, I always say, more than just a feel-good intervention. It used to drive me crazy when I was walking through the hospital hallways with my therapy animal, and, you know, you'd see a doctor come up and they would just say, oh, that's really cute. And yes, it is cute, but I wanted to just get them, get their attention for a moment and talk to them about how this is something that's been studied for a long time and has some promising results. So one of the most common places we bring therapy animals is into medical settings. And this is everything from hospitals to long-term recovery centers to just doctor's office and dental's offices. And we know that the presence of therapy animals reduces fear before these people have treatments and decreases anxiety. We also see some really interesting studies that look at recovery rates. So there have actually been studies that have therapy animals go into hospitals and monitor two different groups' rates of recovery as they come out of, like, things as severe as heart surgery. And those who have visiting with therapy animals recover at more quickly rates at a significant level, which is indicating a lot more going on than we even know to look for. There are some studies that have specific applications for cancer care, and that people who receive visits with therapy animals have lower emotional distress. And one of my favorite studies looked at the idea of positive outlook. There was actually two different groups in this study, and one of the groups got to visit with a therapy animal team, which means a handler and their pet, and one of the groups visited with just a handler, just a human, so we could make sure, you know, at what point is the impact to the therapy animal, at what point is it that you have a special visitor. Both of these groups were receiving chemo over time, and they had the visit either with the animal or with a human during their chemo treatment. After this study, after the six-week study, they asked participants a lot of different questions, but one of the things that came up was that the group who had visited with the therapy animals significantly reported higher rates of feeling better about their health. They thought they were doing better. They said that they had a positive outlook. They thought that their body was recovering. And this finding was true even though at that point they had not yet had any significant differences in their biomedical markers of how they were doing, but they felt that they were doing better. So I think that that's important, you know, that we can bring hope to people with this intervention, and we know there's so much out there in positive psychology about keeping that hopeful outcome eventually having impacts on our physical health as well. Therapy animals are also commonly applied in mental health settings. They can decrease depression, anxiety, stress, increase important things like energy and social support. And there's a lot of research being done about therapy animals and trauma symptoms. Like I said, we do have a group of animal-assisted crisis response teams that go out in the immediate aftermath of some of these awful things that happen, school shootings, even natural disasters. And when the therapy animals are present immediately after, we can hopefully decrease the crisis from turning into a traumatic experience. It's still going to be a crisis experience, but if they have more support in the immediate aftermath, then maybe we can help those long-term impacts. And this is not just true for people who have a presenting mental health concern. So not just for people who have depression or anxiety, but therapy animals can help promote mental wellness for even the population who are generally considered well. So we go to nursing homes, to schools, like I said, but we also go to corporate settings. We go to universities. So places where there isn't necessarily a presenting problem, but we can bring about change. And when we go to environments like these corporations, we see people get along better. We see people showing up on time, people feeling that their business supports them more. So some valuable findings there. Animals connect us. They increase our pro-social behavior and our engagement. We can know even on these new online platforms in which we're all connecting these days, how often are you showing your animals and feeling a connection because of that? When we have animals in group settings, whether it be for a group mental health counseling session or even a social event, there tends to be more interaction between the humans if an animal is there. With this, we have found that people with autism are one of the groups that respond best to therapy animal interventions, that animals can promote social learning, especially for young people with autism. And we have a member of our Human Animal Bond Advisory Board who has done a lot of research specifically in this population and has found some really promising results. We have a few special programs that are based on some of the research in this field. We have a Read With Me program. You can see in this picture a really cute Herbie here. Their handler actually created a book, you know, on one of those websites so that they could bring a book to the children who are practicing reading. But not only do we hear great testimonies of how these reading programs go, but there's science that say that by reading to an animal, we can see more literacy, fluency, and even more preference for reading. So I've seen this in action. I actually a couple years ago was in a reading program with the Department of Juvenile Justice in my state. And at that time, I had a bulldog named Charlie. She's since passed away, but she was just a brilliant therapy animal, came to me in rough shape, was brought into the vet to be euthanized because she was found on the street, was starving, had broken ribs. But I was actually just taking her home for the night to give her a last good evening, and then fell in love with her and was like, so how much is this surgery going to cost? And $6,000 later, I had a dog. But she lived and was a wonderful therapy animal. I would take her into settings, and she would just sometimes was guilty of snoring, and she would fall asleep when they would read her stories. But over the 6-week periods that she would have these young adults and teenagers read to her, their fluency and confidence in reading, the scores were unbelievable. And I think it had a lot to do with that non-judgmental audience that they got to read to. We also have a Walk With Me program, and this is where we encourage teams to get out and walk. Not everybody can have a pet, so that's one of the reasons therapy animal work is so impactful. We will go sometimes to senior living communities with our therapy animal teams and invite people to join us on walks and get them moving. We have a world's largest pet walk event coming up in September, which you'll hear more about at the end of this presentation. So we encourage you to check that out and to help be an advocate for this cause using your love for animals as a way to do so. Finally, just a note about some of the studies on therapy animal work. It's that the research is all over the place in terms of the populations that benefit. So we have studies with young children, with college students, with adults, with elderly populations, especially with people with dementia. One of my dog's favorite places to visit was a memory care unit at a senior living facility, and it was amazing. She would go in, and there was a woman there who could not remember, you know, her family, could not remember much of anyone who she had met at a certain time in her past, but if my dog was there, she could remember her kids. And so they would oftentimes request that she would come and join the sessions, and something about her being there, which we don't know on from a scientific perspective yet exactly what's going on, but she could remember her loved ones, and it was a beautiful thing to be able to watch. And like I said earlier, this is an intervention for people who are sick, for people who are well, and everywhere in between. You can use this intervention to help with a presenting problem and also just to encourage wellness. It's not just an intervention that is well received by animal lovers. We have looked at in research, okay, so is it only crazy animal people like me who are going to benefit? But even those who don't identify as animal lovers and who don't have pets at home have benefited from interacting with therapy animals. So now we'll shift a little bit and look at the difference between therapy animals, assistance or service animals, and emotional support animals. This is just a field that we are really passionate about bringing some awareness to. We see that animals, pets who have no official title and working animals all have value, but there's also tremendous value in the general public knowing the difference. We have a major problem where people can just go online and order a vest and put it on their animal and show up in places, and that's just not a good thing for so many reasons. Number one, not all animals enjoy going out and being in these situations, and not all animals are certainly not trained to do so, and can cause health risk and safety risk. So with the more awareness that we have about the different working animals, the more empowered we are to kind of monitor this. The best way to explain, though, the difference between a therapy animal and an assistance or service animal and an ESA is that a therapy animal has a one-to-many relationship. So if I'm out with my dog, who's a therapy animal, I often say, you know, she is here to bring love to anyone who walks up to us on the street. She's not here to do a job for me. She's here to do a job for you. With assistance animals, service animals, and ESAs, that is not true. They are out on that leash to serve the person who is holding the other end of the leash. So with that in mind, it is not okay to approach the service animals, assistance animals, or emotional support animals because they need to be in tune to their handler for whatever job they're performing. My dogs, I put a big sign on their vest that says, therapy animal, please pet me, because oftentimes I see people walk up and look at them and then they're trying to be respectful. They see the vest and think, oh, I'm not supposed to interact with her. And it drives her nuts when she didn't have that sign on her. She would be the worst service animal in the world. She like makes this incredible eye contact with everyone who walks by, falls over and shows her belly. She's not paying any attention to me. She wants to greet the new people. So we get a lot of career change dogs, as we call them, in the service in the therapy dog industry. These are service dogs who failed out for being too flirty. So they end up being therapy animals. It's a new title, relatively in the field, and we're doing a lot of work to bring some standardization around around this designation. We believe that animals do absolutely provide a lot of emotional support, but it will be a field that is better protected when there's more regulations. As of right now, there's really more evaluations in place for therapy animals and assistance or service animals. Therapy animals do not have the same rights as emotional support animals and service animals. So generally, they are not allowed to fly in the cabin of an airplane. They are not, you don't get a pass if you're renting and there's a no pets policy if there's a therapy animal. Although we have found a lot of times our handlers will send letters in and explain what their animal does, and it changes the perspectives of the landlord. Therapy animals do not have special rights to access public locations, and we train our handlers to really represent that well and to not, you know, just put a vest on your animal and try to trick an establishment into having them come in and simply ask. And oftentimes you might be pleasantly surprised that places will allow the therapy animals in. So this is a quickly developing field, as we talked about earlier, especially when it comes to flying with an animal. Each airline is different and they change regulations quite frequently, but there is no national registry of service animals. An animal is a service animal if you can explain that they have a job that they perform for you. So be careful if you're out there shopping around and someone's trying to charge you a lot of money for registering your animal somewhere, because it's just not a protected field. There's no one right way to go about it. So any questions? I know that's a lot of jargon and a lot to process. Any questions about the difference between these kinds of animals?
Look to see if anybody has a hand raised. Okay, Caesar.
Now, are these recognized across all 50 states or just specific states?
It's a great question. So there are different regulations and recognitions. Even, you know, we've seen in some states different county ordinances about different therapy animals versus assistance animals. Service animals and assistance animals are protected across all states. If you say that your animal is a service animal or assistance animal, they should have rights, you know, that are related to your rights as someone who needs special provision and, you know, has special needs that the service animal assist with. Therapy animals are also recognized in all 50 states, although there is, again, no registration.
Go ahead.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Good. All right. It's about to storm here in Georgia where I live, so hoping we don't have any issues with internet. But so yes, in a nutshell, this changes frequently. Look up online and for any questions that you have specific to where you live. And if you ever have questions, you run into an issue, you can really feel free to email me and I can help find out, you know, if you are trying to get into access to a place with your animal according to one of these titles, reach out and we can provide assistance. So.
Anybody else have a question? I'm looking to see if there's a hand raised. Is it Lee? Did you want to ask a question?
No. I was just glad to hear that Dr. Chastain is available if we have questions further down the line, because I know it does make some difference depending on where you're located. Thanks.
Yes, absolutely. Definitely. And we like to know too, even if you don't have a question, if you have an experience that you can share, because it is, we always say it's the wild, wild west out here in the working animal world, and we find people with new experiences all the time. So feel free to let us know. It can at least inform our advocacy as we go and try to create education and get better representation for people who have animals in their lives. So always welcome to reach out. Even if it's just with a cute animal picture, you can send that to me too. Perfect. All right, so let's talk about how you can get involved. This will be my last part of my formal presentation, and then we can just open up for conversation. But there are many different ways that you can share your love of animals with the world. And the first thing would be to consider, do you have an animal who could be a good candidate to be an official therapy animal? We have a process through petpartners.org that you can go and learn all about. And it's something that even with this COVID madness, you could start working on now, because the first step to becoming a therapy animal team is to go through training as the handler. We believe that if you're out working with an animal, you should have a base level of education that provides you to be that animal's advocate and to represent the field well. So we have in-person trainings. You can search for those if that's something you're interested in, but that handler course is also available online, and it's a really informative course that you can do at your own pace and go ahead and get that, you know, under your belt so that you're ready to take the evaluation with your animal when the time comes. The evaluations with animals, as you can imagine, have been made a bit more challenging this year because they were basically all stopped for several months as we sheltered in place. But we are starting to have some evaluators who are open again for testing, and they have special considerations in place to keep everyone safe. It's a fine line that we're trying to walk right now, because we obviously want everyone on our volunteer leaders and new teams to be healthy and protected. And we also see more of a need than ever before for people to visit with our animals. So we're doing all we can to still churn out new teams. That evaluation, you're going to want to have a basic level of obedience with your animal, and this is different for different species, so not all species are required to sit and lay down, as you can imagine, but for example, with dogs, there's going to be a sit, down, come, stay, leave it, and then there's an aptitude test where we have an evaluator who is going to do things like hug your dog, look into their ears, a object will be dropped, creating a loud noise, the animal will be around medical equipment. It's an involved test just to make sure that not only is the animal a good fit for interacting in this capacity, but that the handler is ready to be that animal's advocate. And, you know, if, for example, there's a part of the test where you come up and you're crowded by several people, we're not looking that the animal would just sit back and accept that. We're looking that the handler would be able to say, all right, one moment, we don't want to crowd the animal. Can everyone sit back? And when you're ready, or when I direct you, can you pet the animal like this, for example? We really want the animal to have as much of a voice as possible in these interactions. And we are not looking for robotic reactions. It's funny because in my experience, my best therapy animals are actually kind of my rowdiest, least obedient ones. Every time I go take a therapy animal evaluation, I just really have to cross all my fingers and toes, because my poodles are, it's hit or miss if they're going to perform their tricks. They're very smart. They have a mind of their own. One time my border collie, I took him for an evaluation, and I had this kind of like preacher's kid moment where I was feeling a lot of pressure. I'm a trainer. I'm representing Pet Partners. What if I fail? But I had worked myself up into so much anxiety that my dog was acting very differently. And so we were walking on the leave it course where he was supposed to leave various stuffed animals on the ground, which he's done a million times. But I think he was trying to make me loosen up. So I went by the course, and he picked them up and threw them in the air and then spontaneously dead-dogged, and it was a nightmare. So we had to redo the evaluation. So don't be scared if you are going to go out and do your evaluation. We all have, we get those try-again scores. And as long as the animal does not show aggression, then they can come back and reevaluate. Once you go through this process, you have your formal registration and you can visit wherever you'd like. We have a certificate of insurance, so you're covered by our liability insurance should something happen. And usually this is not a bite. This is, I think, one of our biggest insurance claims to date was a dog picked up someone's hearing aid and damaged it in a senior living environment, and we stepped in to help in that situation. We do reevaluate our animals every 2 years because animals change more quickly than us humans do. Animals experience burnout, and we want to make sure that, you know, we're prepared to monitor how they receive people over time and that they continue to be a really good fit for their therapy and will work. And then we have this whole new brand new initiative that I've been mentioning throughout, but it's called animal related engagement. And this idea actually was born in response to this COVID crisis. Back when everything was shutting down, we saw our handlers go through a really, really challenging time, not just because there's people who they have sometimes been visiting every week for years who now they can't visit. Their animals were different. Their animals were bored. Mine will go grab their therapy animal vest and drop it in my lap. Like, come on, mom. I don't know why we're not leaving the house. They don't quite understand what we're doing. And our handlers really felt that they wanted to show the people who they typically visited with that they were thinking of them. We also saw at this time this really interesting thing happen where all of the videos that were going viral online were cute animal videos and pictures. When we're all stuck in our house, we seem to all go and want to look at these kinds of things. I don't know if anyone else saw, but at least here in Georgia, so many people started sharing on social media these little picnic tables that they would put on their trees for squirrels to sit at. And so, you know, we thought, man, what, this is interesting. We're all turning towards animals right now. So we started to look at the research around this and found that actually there's a lot of research that suggests that just by considering animals, we can see some of the benefits that we talked about earlier that are commonly associated with therapy animal work. We see better mood, we see more productivity, we see less loneliness and social isolation just by watching videos of animals and things like that. So we defined this term, animal-related engagement, as any engagement opportunity that allows participants the benefit of the human-animal bond by encouraging the remembrance of feelings that are commonly associated with interaction with an animal. So it's a mouthful. We do have a white paper that you can download for free on our website at the link at the bottom of this slide that goes through all the research, and it is an interesting read to see what we know out there. There's even some researchers who looked at watching animal videos at work producing having more productivity and staff. So maybe you can send that to your boss if you ever get stuck, if you get caught looking at animal videos while you're on the clock. But in that white paper packet, we also have some suggested activities for how you can bring about this positive change in your community. We have a coloring book of therapy animals that can be downloaded. We have book lists that can be suggested. We have a virtual visit guide. We also have a Facebook page that anyone can join. If you have an animal, we invite you to take cute pictures, videos, and to upload them to that Facebook page because we have shared that with thousands of facilities all around the world, senior living homes, children's hospitals, and there are staff that are going every day and finding the new content and sharing it with people who are in their care, and it is making a really big difference. So if you have an animal who might not even be a good candidate for therapy animal work, I'm sure they would be a good candidate for being in a cute video. So you can share your animal that way. You can download some of these resources and call your local senior living facility and say, hey, I just learned about animal-related engagement. Could I drop off some coloring book pages and markers to give your residents? Different things like that that are really, really meaningful. It's, you know, whatever we can do to connect with one another right now, I encourage us to check out. And animals are a really great way to bridge that connection. And there's different ways you can create curriculum for people about if you're interested in a species that maybe people don't know about, create a video about that species, even if you don't have an animal, create a PowerPoint and share it on the Facebook page. There are people who are really enjoying that content. Right now, with everyone finding themselves in this homeschool situation, we see a lot of people now are offering to have FaceTime sessions or Zoom sessions with their animal and have kids on the other end of the screen practice reading to animals over a digital platform. So great ways to get involved in your community, and we hope that you'll check that out and learn more about how you can share love of animals in this way. So this is my final slide, and then we'll open it up for conversation. But I am here to stay in touch. My email address is not on there. It's taylorc@petpartners.org. But you can reach out to me there. You can check out our website, more material than you'll ever want about the human-animal bond. We have active social media pages. We have some upcoming Facebook Live events all throughout the fall with some amazing presenters talking about everything from therapy bunnies to more things about research on the human-animal bond. And these are really engaging opportunities for you to chat and comments and questions. So please consider joining us on some of those presentations. We have online webinars and videos available through our YouTube page. And we do have this big World's Largest Pet Walk event, which you can check out too. So we're always looking for more people who love animals enough to join a two-hour call on a Friday afternoon to talk about it. So y'all are probably the people who could help take us further in all of these efforts. So we hope that you'll continue to connect with us that way. So now let's open it up for questions. And then if we wanted to do an animal show and tell, I can try to wake up one of my dogs. they're done. They're like, thank God it's Friday. We're tired. So
wonderful. Okay. So why don't you, if you could remove the screen share?
Yes. Let's see.
And there were three comments I saw. Oop, here we go. I did see three comments. Andrea, did you have a question?
Yes. So I would love it if my dog Ruby could be a therapy dog, but she is not right. So I was wondering if there's a program where people can train to work with therapy animals, but use other animals of maybe that are maybe people that don't want to be go in person but want their animals to.
Yeah, that's a great question. You are allowed to register with an animal that you don't own. And so our requirement is just that you've known the animal for a year so that you have a solid relationship with them. But we have a lot of people on our program who have a friend or a neighbor with like a great golden retriever. And they say, you know, you might not want to get out and do this, but I would love to. Do you mind if I evaluate with your pet? And they do. So it's you're open to anybody's pet who you can borrow and that you're welcome to take the test with. So absolutely.
Oh, thank you. So a close friend of mine does have a therapy dog that she used for several years. She would visit a nursing home with her. He's a standard schnauzer.
Oh, great. Wow.
And used to be my dog's boyfriend before he got her. Anyway. So my friend's husband has been going through cancer treatment for a long time, and it seems like he needs her to be around more. I was thinking of maybe asking her. I don't know if she'd be okay with that, but I am available to do that. So yeah, that's good. Thanks for addressing that.
Absolutely. And we have a lot of, there's research out there too about how much, if it's the right animal, it really enriches their life. So you could also try selling it that way. It's a good outing for animals. And most of them that have that really affiliative nature, wanting the attention, love it. And you'll find you will create a monster though. I mean, mine with this whole shutdown, like, I have to beg the mailman to be like, just come say hi to my dogs. They need to talk to someone. So they get used to it and really love it. So
that's wonderful. Thank you. It looks like David and then Glenn.
Yes. How's the audio?
Great.
Okay. David from Palm Springs. Thank you. Such a meaningful presentation. Thank you. Question for you. We're lucky enough to be accepted on a waiting list for a Tibetan Terrier. Do you have any insight of this breed? It is considered the holy dog and one of the oldest.
Yes. So. Yes. I have worked with some before. I know you're about to get a very intelligent little creature in your home. And so, again, with any animal, it's funny because there are definitely different avenues for different breeds. I have everything from, I've had an Irish wolfhound to the leader of my pack is a 5-pound Yorkie poo. But when you're working with a really intelligent breed, you want to start these enrichment activities from a very young age. And especially if you have goals to do therapy animal work in the future, or any kind of work in the future, I would suggest finding a trainer in your area who can help walk you through that process. We have a lot of different trainers who we've worked with in the past, and you'll want to also join our Facebook Live offerings because we have them come on and talk about, you know, when we're stuck in the house, how do we keep our animals engaged? What kind of jobs can we give them? So, you know, anything that you have in place, the worst thing you can do for a really intelligent breed is not give them a job. And so I would go out of town. I traveled a lot for work before this all happened. And I have a standard poodle who is boisterous and confident and really intelligent. And if you don't tell him what to do, he will find something to do. So my dad called me halfway through one of my work trips and was like, you have to come home. This dog is opening my fridge, turning on and off my water, getting in the oven. And I'm like, Dad, just ask him to join you on your chores. Ask him for little commands. And that's one of the best ways to keep them happy.
Okay, good to know. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Glenn and then Alistair.
So I was wondering if you had the program established anywhere outside of the U.S. I just went on your website and answered that question myself, but I don't see the U.K. in the list. Is there any plans on opening up to the U.K. in the future?
Absolutely. We are very interested in any kind of international growth, and this really just follows where we have someone who's willing to be a volunteer leader. So to start a group, we go through a process of training our evaluators. These are the people who conduct the tests so that we can add therapy animals to our team. So if you are anywhere you are, whether it be internationally or domestically, and you find that there's not an active pet partners presence in your area, we can help you get set up with a program. We're typically, these require in-person meetings to train someone to become an evaluator. So we would say, can you find 3 or 5 people who are interested in being leaders with you, and we'll come and send a practicum there to get people ready. We're trying out some online trainings right now, given the times. And we hope that maybe even in the future, if things normalize, this can be adapted to increasing our international presence. So it all comes down to where we have someone who is willing to help us take the charge and lead there. So we're wanting to go anywhere and everywhere we can. We actually, hopefully, we just made a new contact with someone in India earlier this week. So we're all over the world.
Wonderful. So Glenn, is that something that you'd be interested in spearheading?
Possibly.
He's like, don't tell her my email address. She's going to sign me up.
But we have Lula here today too, and she's in the UK. Maybe the two of you, if Lula's into animals and would be interested in doing something like that.
Yeah, definitely. I'd definitely be more interested in learning more about it.
Wonderful. Well, you can definitely be in touch with Dr. Chastain and follow through with her, and she can direct you to what other resources on the website. That's awesome. Great. Love to see something like that happen for you guys in the UK.
Thanks.
I think, Alistair, you had a question also?
Yes. Given the enormity that COVID has in all our lives at the moment, I was curious if you were preemptively managing to keep track of the various species of different animals which have been established as able to catch COVID and potentially pass it on. Even though there isn't enough information to have a clue as to whether or not the pets can actually pass it on to their owners.
That's a great question. We have been actively researching this. We're lucky to have some of the top zoonosis experts who inform the CDC on our Human Animal Bond Advisory Board. And we have, anyone who goes through our training is gonna see Pet Partners is notorious for having the highest standards in terms of zoonosis and infection prevention, even before all of this happened. We require that our animals receive a bath 24 hours before visiting. The handlers have to carry hand sanitizer and use before and after every interaction. We limit things such as, like, we don't allow costumes on our animals because the more cloth you have on an animal, the more likely they can pass just anything. So we have a lot of training on that in general, and we are following as closely as we can. It is crazy, as we know more than just in the animal world. It seems like we're learning new things about COVID every day. And most of our visits have ceased for now in person. We are starting to see some people who are medical professionals or mental health professionals who are already planning on being in the hospital. So nurses, for example, are returning to work with their animals, thinking, you know, if I'm more likely as the person to pass it on, per our understanding. But we've had to get our animals used to things like face masks, which is a whole new thing. So it's a constantly developing situation, but we fall back on the gold standard of infection prevention that we already have in place, and feel that our handlers are some of the most prepared people in the world to interact in a way that's cognizant of not spreading infection. Because, you know, even before this happened, we're visiting with children in the hospital with compromised immune systems or whoever it may be. So this is something that we've had to respect for a really long time.
Thank you.
Any other questions? I didn't see any hands. Nina, I wanted to ask you, of all the fosters that you have with you right now, are any available for adoption?
Actually, four of my own personal dogs, two are fosters. They're a little more difficult to place, though, because one is a 10-pound terrier, and he was very reactive. So I had him for several months. Then he went to one of our rescue partners from Texas up in Washington State. He was adopted out. Loved the mom, loved the female. Didn't care for the teenagers in the house. The husband didn't really care for him, so they kind of kept their distance. But he bit her mom, and her husband had a fit and said he was dangerous and he needed to be put down. And our rescue said, no, he's coming back. So I took him back. I'm working with him a lot. And then I have a blind Boston Terrier who's a senior. He has heartworm and he has a heart murmur, so he can't do the standard heartworm treatment. But they are both adoptable. It just, Scruffy, he's like a little grumpy old man, and he will find his right human. And we get requests on him through our rescue group, but I vet them pretty well. And they think, oh, he's just a cute little dog, he'll be okay. I go, no, because if he doesn't like something, he'll bite. He'll even try it with me, but he knows better. We have a pretty good relationship going. Cats, I probably have about 10, and most of those are fosters available to be adopted. So I help a lot with friends who live in Doha, Qatar, in the Middle East, and it's a really brutal place for animals to live on the street. So I help with do temp fostering, transporting, flying on the airplane. They fly in cargo, I fly inside the airplane, because their Salukis are about 65-pound dogs. It's precious. We place them all over the U.S. So this is really great for me, because some of these dogs, especially the Saluki breeds, super friendly, very loving, great temperament, and we have them placed all over the U.S. So this will be a great program to share with them, because they're very active. They need to be busy. And so this will be a perfect program for a lot of people. And there's our Ruby, Andrea's baby girl. So yes, and oh, look at yours. I have a blue healer, I have a black mouth cur, and then the rest, like my toy poodle here.
Uh-huh.
Baby.
So cute.
She runs the house, trust me. She runs the house, yes. Not much just awesome. By her. Yeah, people keep Thank talking you. About, oh, people trying to break into your house. I go, just get a dog. There's no way on God's green earth anyone would get in this house, I'm telling you. But I'm excited about this program, so thank you for bringing this up, Sunny.
You're welcome. I hope to see you more often. So, what was I going to say? I have attempted in the past to register and train and become certified with my pets, and have failed miserably because I don't know whether it's me and or the pets that I choose, but my dogs are all too kissy. And that's one thing that they say, no, your dog can't be a licker. And the first thing my dogs want to do is kiss you in the face. But that's something that I encourage because I love it. And yeah. I see, Lee, you had a question, my darling?
Actually, there's a whole range of thoughts I have about some of this, but
good.
Let me start with my dog is a emotional support dog for both myself and my husband, which is pretty unusual in and of itself. Has also been trained to do service work for both of us. Has the kind of temperament of the dogs you're talking about. If we're out walking or something and disabled person or someone else comes up, she has a natural inclination to assist with those. She doesn't unless I ask their name and then say, Bose, would you like to say hello to whatever their name is? That gives her permission to go over and see them, and she changes in personality to some degree. So I don't know if she'd be eligible to do this kind of work, but it also kind of indicates the differences in the different kinds of dogs that we have. Here in California, we're protected in some levels, but I've also had to make sure the dog was AKC trained and certified as she's not a purebred, she's a Chiweenie. So, she's a registered AKC partner. She's gone through the good citizen trainings, and then she's had special training with each of us for our specific needs. So I think that helps clarify some of the differences. Now, on a kind of different thought, then you can comment on any of this. And I'm glad that Sunny's here, and I'm a commissioner, I'm an anthropologist also, on the Los Angeles County Commission on HIV. We set priorities and allocations and standards for all the HIV care for the massive LA County, those of you from elsewhere. And in Southern California, we work closely with some of the other commissions. And for years, I've been advocating that in our, what we call a continuum of care, it should actually be a caring continuum, that animals are involved. For a long time, there's been issues about people coming to waiting rooms of AIDS organizations, and as we become more professionalized, people get frustrated, people leave, people don't get treated properly. My thought has always been, we put a therapy dog in that setting, that would help staff, that would help clients. You mentioned you do research. I guess I'm sort of like saying, think about in that context. And even now, looking at all of you, my dog, once I get on Zoom, she knows to go and take care of my husband. but that I have some fellow commissioners here. They don't take me seriously, quite honestly, on the commission when I talk about this stuff. It's like, oh, it's another one of those things. But, and then the third thing I'd like you to comment on, and then I'll get off. Active drug users, one of our main at-risk target populations. They're hard to keep in care. They're hard to get to keep appointments. We find them on the street oftentimes. Takes a different kind of outreach. Yet over the years, because I've, as an anthropologist, I've worked very closely with being in the field with them, I find that no matter how unstable their lives may be, many of them have their own pets, their own dogs, that they will feed first, even if they're homeless, even if they can't get their drugs. They'll take care of that dog. That dog will be with them. And if the dog is ever lost, as has been and happened in a few cases, it's devastating. So might there be a way to help engage or maintain an engagement with that population? It's syringe exchange programs, for example. I'm kind of suggesting other places you guys might think about doing therapy in a way of countering it. The other possibility is, would you be interested in doing this presentation with the commission? Kind of, you know, do a little bit of animal mind expansion with our fellow species that we're not so distant from.
Yes, absolutely. I am more than happy to give the presentation anywhere it can be helpful. And also on that note, for anyone, if you're ever approaching, you have an idea, and you know, you get that look sometimes, like you want to bring a dog to the clinic, like we see that. So if you ever are trying to advocate for this and you need some support, reach out and let me know where you're going, because I can send articles, I can send a synopsis of research in the population. There are studies, for example, of animals in waiting rooms. There are studies of animals impacting nurses in a positive way, doctors in a positive way. We have really close relationship with the Human Animal Bond Research Institute, HABRI, and one of their main focuses is showing, you know, how pet ownership for all people, for homeless people, low-income people, anyone, is such an important right that people have, and there should be funding available to assist with that. And so we're highly engaged in that capacity, and between us and them, anytime you're going to bat for where there is a bring about change, let me know and we can get you the resources so that you're really prepared to go in. As for your dog, we do have service animals and emotional support animals can still be therapy animals. So as long as it's an okay situation where they can take off one hat and wear the other hat, we find that it's a really good way. A lot of times people with service animals love to give back and provide some education. They can go out and we have stories of people who have a service animal who has a therapy animal hat, and they go out and find someone who could really be benefited by having a service animal of their own, and they help them along that process so that they can have their own service animal. So it's a really great way to all work together, you know, with a shared interest. So yes, I hope that answered some questions, but
yeah, and I'll get you email and stay in touch for those other reasons, and maybe my fellow commissioners will be more supportive with when these conversations come up, guys. You see? Pet Partners is here also in Los Angeles. Where are you? Across the country, everywhere with locations where this kind of certification and things can happen?
We are. So our headquarters is in Seattle. We're actually a really small staff, though. I think there's about 25 of us. Now we all work remotely, but we were mostly remotely before. But we have what we call community partners, and those are groups of volunteers who have almost operate like book clubs. So they get together. We have them listed on our website. So when you go to petpartners.org, you can see if there's a community partner nearby. Even if there's not a community partner nearby, there's a good chance there's a handler somewhere nearby who you could connect with. When you go through our process, you also get a link to join our online community. So, for example, last year I lived in Atlanta, and then last year I moved out to Lake Hartwell, which is a very remote area, and there were no other handlers around me, but I still had that community of people to support me from Pet Partners Online, and I'm working to create a new group here. So we are everywhere. We have leaders in most major cities, but even if not, we have leaders who make themselves available for things like Skype calls and can help other people get started.
Thank you. Well, I would like to say thank you to Lee and to Alistair and to Thomas for being here. They're all on the Los Angeles HIV Commission. It is no small task, it is no small job, and sometimes it goes unthanked, and I want to thank you. I might have seen you, Lee, at one of the commission meetings with your little pup, right? Yes, okay, so I do remember that. And I was also on your commission meeting, your committee meeting, Zoom the other day, and...
Public policy, right?
Yes, and it is... I just had my head spinning. I can just imagine if everybody had a dog in their lap, how much more amiable people would be.
That's a really good thought. I like that idea.
No, maybe we just need to bring in a bunch of dogs and puppies to one of the commission meetings and let them loose.
We need to get you on the commission too, Sonny.
You know, you guys keep after me, and you know, I'm just trying to find the place where my gifts would be best used.
Speaking of that, though, if you do want animals at these meetings, we have a place online, even if you just, quickest way to get to it is post an opportunity at Google Pet Partners, post an opportunity. You can put an opportunity there and an email goes out to our handlers in the area, and you could see if anyone's available to come, because we do have like stressful school board meetings sometimes all around the country, and they'll say, hey, can anyone bring a therapy animal? And they show up and it helps. So you can post an opportunity as well.
That's very cool.
That's brilliant, actually. I one of the things that happens, and Sonny was talking about I chair the public policy committee, and both co-chairs have animals, and it oftentimes relieves a lot of stress around very intense conversations on very difficult issues when they just happen to pop up on screen.
I bet.
Absolutely.
Thanks for sharing that. That's actually a good resource.
Yes. I think one of the Zooms I was on last week was also in the middle of a heated conversation, and all of a sudden somebody's cat just walked right by them, right across their keyboard. And a few years ago when we were taking our Pause Life Weekend seminar to Palm Springs, I did a bunch of outreach and had stopped at one of the drug treatment facilities. And as soon as you walk into the door, three golden retrievers ran up to you with these smiles and happiness. And I already felt like this is where I need to be, but I could just imagine. I mean, that's your welcoming committee. That's the first face you see when you come into a place for help, are these little happy dogs that just, you know, want to be there for you. And I think that's awesome.
That is awesome.
Yeah.
Yes, we have a huge need. It reminds me, that's one of our biggest places that I would like to see more teams being able to visit is in correctional environments and in prisons. You know, you think that's a place where affection is not allowed, and so you know, we bring our animals in and it gives people that ability to hug something and receive affection, and other facilities, drug treatment facilities, things like that will sometimes have facility animals who live there, but we can't seem to get enough facility animals in prisons and in jails. So if that's a place that you might have a calling to go, that I would love to see more people visiting in that space.
Wonderful. Well, Lee, I am very happy to jump on any committee that involves dogs and cats and animals. So as soon as the commission adds a committee on dogs, cats, and animals, I'll be the first to sign up for that. I think
Taylor,
Nina had another question.
Yeah. Taylor, could you just reconfirm your email address again?
Absolutely. It's taylorc@petpartners.org.
Okay. Thanks.
You can always reach out to me as well.
Absolutely.
And I give you all the links in the website.
Yeah, I think that part, only because I'm a huge fan of Villalobos Rescue, pit bulls and parolees.
Yes.
And I've seen the difference that makes when dog programs are in prisons.
Yes.
Because it gives gives inmates who have to be tough, are able to show and bring out their softer side,
yes,
the more human side, yeah, by
absolutely
working with the dog. Animals to me are the best medicine ever.
They are.
Ever. So this is exciting to learn this different program, because I'm with one of the biggest, I foster for one of the biggest rescues in Dallas, and the cases we take are just amazing. But you know, from little, you know, easy to adopt ones to,
yep,
some of the most horrific abuse neglect cases. And so many people love that idea of wanting to get their animal as a therapy dog, but they really didn't know how. Or with COVID now, things are kind of shut down. But understanding more about your program is great, and I'd love to share this information with all my Texas people too.
Yes, please do. And it's not just, it's any animal. Right. So it's so funny, right? We go into, I would never forget, I went into a prison one time with my, she's a 10-pound miniature poodle. And at first all the guys were like, I want a cooler dog. And within 5 minutes she had him on the floor, rolling around, playing with her. I'm like, come on boys, like this
I've
dog.
Done enough adoption events in especially Dallas area. And you'll see these big, burly football-looking guys, and they're coming in with their little teeny tiny dog. Yeah. And I go, you gotta love it. But I also see a lot of people with hedgehogs.
Yeah.
Kinkajou. I met a kinkajou, which is like a primate of some sort. Hmm. Kind of like a big raccoon in a way. Yeah, and especially when you do adoption events at pet stores, and you see snakes. Lizard. I mean, it's just amazing what people find fascinating and repelling at the same time. But it's like, oh, that's so cute. I want to learn more about it. Because I have a friend here who has a virtual zoo. She and her wife rescue every kind of animal, camels, zebras, wallabies. Yeah. But animals make the world go round. And I'm so excited that there's programs like this. Thank you.
Thank you for your share. I have one question and then one other comment. And some of you know this about me and some of you don't. But I have an equine facilitated mental health program that I operate here at my ranch up in the mountains. And I have specifically worked with differently abled children with autism and Down syndrome. And the miracles I have seen working with the horses and children with autism that don't speak has been astounding. I don't get to do that as often as I have in the past because Life Group has kind of taken over my life the last 15 years, but it is something that I enjoy doing. And then my question is for Taylor, is there a specific breed and or male or female that is better suited for this kind of work going into hospitals, et cetera?
It's a great question. We have, you know, you do see some of the, there's no such thing as a hypoallergenic dog, but some of the low shedding dogs are sometimes going to be more well received by hospitals. We are huge advocates for our pitties. In my experience, pit bulls can be one of the most brilliant therapy animals in the world. Golden retrievers, like the typical, we have a lot of them too. I think they're one of our most common breeds. As a dog trainer, I really believe that it isn't about the individual breed, it's about the interplay between the person and the animal. I, for so long, wanted to have this really, like, badass therapy dog. Like, I wanted to be able to walk in with a German Shepherd into a facility, and I realized I couldn't do it because I tend to be a more, as much as I like to be a strong, independent woman, when I go out in the world, sometimes I'm a little bit more fear-based, and if I had a protection breed, they were picking up on that, and they were like, no, Mom, I'm here to protect you. I don't care about other people. So my goofy poodles, who are like, Mom, you got it. It's fine. That's who I do best with. I also tend to work better with female dogs. I think because there's probably a whole case study you guys could do on me, but I tend to baby male dogs more. I don't know why. And I'm like, to my female dogs, they just are more independent and less Velcro-y, and they do better. So I think it really relates to how we as individuals interact with each individual animal. And then look at the breed differences, though. There is something to be said about, you know, where high-energy breeds are going to do better, where, you know, small animals might be able to sit on people's laps more easily. On the contrary, I had an Irish wolfhound who was wonderful to visit with because she could visit with people in hospital beds without getting on their lap because she was tall enough. So there's a lot of different considerations that go in play. The animal who balances you best is likely going to be the one who does best work with you. So
Thank you for that. Any other questions or comments? No, we're kind of all questioned out.
All my critters are asleep. Usually I get no personal space because they're on my head. I woke her up so she could say hi. She's my rescue mama. All my rescues. I know. Now it's probably going to be potty time. So, yeah. Oh, I have a blue wheel of that.
Oh, look. Let's do show and tell before we
grab my little one.
Yes. I have a blue healer, and when he decides he has to go outside, everybody has to go, and he's so loud.
I love my healer.
Oh, my God. Hi.
This is Lucy. She's in charge
of
the pack.
Cute. Yes.
She chases a German Shepherd.
And this is baby.
Baby.
She has the flying nun ears.
That's so cute.
I know. These are my little ones. The rest just get bigger.
Here.
Oh my God.
Oh, you have a healer also. I have a healer.
Yeah, mine is blue. Here.
Mine too.
JC. Come here, JC.
I have to get up and let him in. Otherwise he's
Come here, JC. Come here. Come up. Well, he's blue healer, but he's got to be mixed with a little bit of hound because he doesn't have the square blue healer head. let me switch you around. Hello. Okay. Oh, JC.
Oh, look.
Here he is. Hi. What's up, my boy?
Oh, yeah. That looks like my Norman.
Yeah, so he's a big old baby.
Oh, look at that Basset. How sweet. Look at how he's looking.
Oh, my God. Oreo, come here. Come here, Oreo. Oreo, come here. There's my little blind boy. Hi. And as he shreds his toys, he takes those suckers and he has no teeth. Yeah. Probably the only decent thing that these people who had him previously did was get him fixed. Other than that, his skin is horrible. He has little lipomas. He's got growths. His teeth are just worn down to nothing. But he just couldn't be happier. And he
very
just
cool.
runs all around and he doesn't. When I got him, he still had his eyes. They were to the point really, if they weren't removed, enucleated, then they were going to. Yeah. It's not pretty when that happens.
Painful.
Yeah, and so, but he never seemed to care, but that's what we did. We had him removed, but his vision was so bad already. So it's amazing. He'll run around the yard and he runs right up to the back door like he knows where it's at. Okay,
that's
who wants to go outside?
All right.
Let's go. Yeah.
Glenn, who do you have there?
This is Ginger.
Hi, Ginger. Very sweet.
She's a 5-year-old French bulldog puggle cross.
Oh my goodness!
Very cute.
So cute.
Very, very cute. And Thomas, what's your pup's name? Oh, you're mute, babe.
Oh, there's my. There's my beauty.
Judy here. She's an Italian Chihuahua.
Aww.
She's 5 years old.
Very cute.
No, it's not going to work.
Very cute. And Mark, I think you were showing us a pup earlier. Oh, yeah, you had the healer. Wait, you're new, babe.
His name is Dice.
Dice. Very cute.
He doesn't want to do anything because it's so hot outside today.
Yes. Totally get it. So for those of you that don't have pets but want to enjoy pets, maybe we could connect each other and do dog walk shares or something like that. Or if somebody had to go to work and somebody wasn't going to work, maybe you could do doggy babysitting or something like that. I'd love to see that, something like that happen.
And here's a love affair. Reagan and this cat, Penelope, were buddies ever since she was a baby. And
very
they would
cute.
Box each other, yeah. And she loved, I have another cat kitten almost grown, black and white, Tuxy, who just thinks the stars rise and set on Reagan.
The little teeny Reagan. Kitten. Thank you, Nina. So you guys, I think if nobody else has any questions, maybe we could let Dr. Chastain get back to her day. Any last burning...
Thank you so much for your presentation. Can you send your presentation to Sunny and she can share it with us and your
sure
email
can.
And contact information? And Sunny, if you want to share mine or ours with the doctor, that would be really cool too.
I'd be happy to
thank
do that.
Thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you. You're so welcome. Dr. Chastain, thank you so much for spending your afternoon with us. I'm so very, very grateful. And I loved the presentation. This is something that I've been wanting to do for quite a while. I'd love for us to all kind of get involved in becoming certified ourselves and seeing how we can give back. I think that being advocates by way of even the commission is a really huge step because it's such a huge body. Hold on one sec. Sorry, Nina. With that, anybody that wants information, just reach out to me. I'll get it from Dr. Chastain. And again, I'm so grateful for your time and that when I reached out to you, you said yes right away. I'm so excited. And I'm looking forward personally to being involved with Pet Partners on a larger scale at some point in the near future in some capacity in which I can be of service.
Yes. Well, thank you for your wonderful work and thank everyone for being here. Anytime we can talk about the power of the human-animal bond, just let us know and we are here for it. So I hope everyone has a wonderful afternoon and do reach out with questions, cute animal photos, whatever you'd like. We'd love to hear from you.
Awesome. So maybe I'll see you guys on the Pet Partners Facebook page and we'll start plastering them with all the cute little pictures, like the one down there that Mike's got of his little pirate dog. All right, you guys.
All right.
Any ideas for future presentations that you'd like to hear? Just let me know. I will make it happen. In the meantime, have a blessed weekend and do something special for yourselves. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye.